If a car travels 60 inches after the wheels turn one time, what is the approximate diameter of each tire? In this lesson, you will learn how to solve for a missing value in a formula by inputting the given variable values and solving the resulting equation. Before we tackle such a problem, let's recall how to solve an equation using inverse operations. In this equation, the variable c is being divided by 6. Since we know the inverse of division is multiplication, we can multiply both sides by 6. Doing so allows us to cancel out the 6s on the left-hand side. Therefore, c equals the product of 3 and 6, which leaves us with the answer of 18. This understanding can help us with formulas such as this one, especially when the question doesn't highlight the intended solution. As we've explored in the previous lesson, the volume is highlighted in the formula's arrangement, which is why it appears first. Yet we want the height. Once we correctly input the values, we must think through the question in order to solve it. This is easy enough now, but what if the numerical values make this challenging? This is where our understanding of solving equations comes into play. To solve this formula, which is an equation, we will use the variable h instead of the question mark. Again, we can input the values we know. Now, we can combine the numerical values on the right-hand side of the equal sign by multiplying 3 and 5.2, giving us 15.6. Knowing that the inverse of multiplication is division, we can isolate the variable h when we divide both sides by 15.6. This will eliminate the 15.6 from the right side, revealing the missing height of 6.5 inches. If we input this value back into our original formula, we can see that the answer works. A rectangular prism with these three dimensions does indeed equal a volume of 101 and 4 tenths cubic inches. Looking back at our answer, however, notice that our variable is on the right-hand side of the equal sign. Why did this happen? In essence, we rearranged the formula by using inverse operations, and highlighted the height as the variable of interest. Yet the order may appear strange. Sounds even stranger when we say it. It currently reads 6.5 equals h. Is the order incorrect? Shouldn't it go the other way? This is a common misunderstanding. The order is interchangeable because the relationship between the variable and the solution is the same in both versions. While we are the most comfortable with reading this answer as the height is 6.5 inches, it could also be that 6.5 inches is the height. Either way, they are both correct, and they are both equivalent statements. So what about the opening question about the car? How big are those tires after all? For that, we'll need to review some vocabulary first. So the diameter is the distance across the circle through the center. In the case of the car, it's the distance through the center of the tire. The circumference, on the other hand, is the distance around the circle. In the case of our problem, this is equivalent to the wheels turning once. Since we are looking for the diameter, we can make use of the circumference formula. Also keep in mind that pi is approximately 3.14. Using this information, we can input the values we know into the formula and then solve for the remaining variable. Knowing that the circumference is 60 inches and that pi has an approximate value, we can replace the c with 60 and pi with 3.14. Using our knowledge of inverse operations, we can divide both sides by pi's approximation and finally get a solution for the variable d. This means that the tires are approximately 19 inches in diameter. What if we have to deal with more complex formulas? Here's the formula for the area of a trapezoid, which we will need for this problem. From the question, we know that the height is 3 inches, the area is 36 square inches, and one of the bases is 14 inches. We are trying to find out the length of the second base. So if we input all of the values into our formula, we end up with this equation. As we start to simplify it, we compute half of 3, which gives us 1.5. The use of parentheses in the formula has us considered one of two approaches. One option is to begin using the inverse operations right away. To undo 1.5 times the sum of 14 and base 2, we are left using division as the inverse operation. Notice that we can use the bar notation, known as avinculum, in place of the standard division sign. After carrying out the division on the left, you may remove the unnecessary parentheses on the right. With subtraction being the inverse of addition, we can subtract by 14 on both sides, revealing a base length of 10 inches. The second option involves using the distributive property to simplify the right side further. If we distribute the 1.5 among the 14 and the base, we end up with 36 equals 21 plus 1.5b. Now, we must use the inverse of addition, giving us a difference of 15 on the left and eliminating the 21 on the right. Since we are left with 1.5 times the base on the right, we use division as our inverse operation. Just as with our first option, we end up with the same answer of 10 inches for the base. This shows us that we can rearrange the formula using inverse operations immediately after inputting values, or we can wait to do so once the formula has been simplified as much as possible. In this lesson, you have learned how to solve for a missing value in a formula by inputting the given variable values and solving the resulting equation.